I can't say thank you enough, Paul, for the kind words, and obviously, to be honest with you, for this tremendous humbling honor. And when David Eagleoff told me that they'd asked me to be the recipient of this year's award, I did a little research on it. And you probably may not know this, maybe you do, but they give an award, they actually get two awards. One for a guy who's unemployed, so I got the unemployed. I got people kind of short, so the guy who has a job can get up here and talk to you about things. But I will say, a lot of people say, what have you been doing? And I did try to get a couple jobs this year. There was a one old retired guy and myself, we get together every morning, we have coffee and breakfast, and just talk about old times. And one day he says, Ted, I'm starting to get a little bit bored. I said, well, what do you want to do? And he said, well, why don't we get a part-time job? I said, what do you got in mind? So I got the one ads here, and there's a security job open down for local junior college. I said, yeah, I'll do it. So we go to the office the next day. We're sitting in the waiting room. The secretary says, hey, one of you guys can go in for the interview. So our buddy goes in first. First thing he knows is that the guy who's doing the interview has no ears. So the guy says, hey, to be a security guard, you gotta be intuitive, you gotta be on top of things, you gotta understand, see things before they happen. So he goes on, asks about 15 minutes of questions. Guy knocks him out of the park, and finally, the guy says, look, last question. Do you notice anything odd or peculiar about me? But he says, you don't have ears. Okay, loses the sack. He says, look, I was born with no ears. It's something that is just, it really irritates me when people talk about it. Get out of here. So he walks out and says, don't say anything about his ears to me. So I go in next. Same thing, you gotta be intuitive. You gotta see things before they happen. Blah, 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 blah. 15 minutes later, I answer all the questions. He says, man, you have knocked this thing out of the park. He says, last question, do you see anything odd or peculiar about me? I looked at him, took a deep breath, I said, you wear contacts.
Exactly. How did you know that?
I said, you sure as hell can't wear glasses. I'm just trying for the life of me to figure out why anybody would have sex with me twice. gonna get that job in. Anyway, I want to do something here real quick. I want to take you through it, and I started thinking about this on the drive over here today. Some moments in time. I bet you, in the 13 years I was here, I have over 1,000 great memories of my time at Ohio State. And for you tonight, I know how much Ohio State basketball means to you. I'm going to take you through a few of my moments. And starting with 2010, Big Ten tournament, 3.2 seconds to go. I'm so mad at our players that we're in this position down two against Michigan. Ball full court, because we had a bye-week leading into it. I knew we were going to play bad. I didn't know we were going to play as bad as we did. So to take a timeout, we got two lights. I tell David Lighty, I said, look, get out there. Here's where I want us to be. I want to see what defense we're in. I'm going to call timeout. So I look out, and they're not picking us up. So I look at David, and I said, let's go. So the ball's in there. Evan Turner catches his dribble up the floor. And all I'm thinking about in my mind is what I'm going to say when I get in the locker room. Because I knew the team had a chance to make a deep run in the NCAA tournament. So I'm like, do I flip out? Here goes the ball. And it's going. I'm like, maybe I should be nice. Not saying anything. Shot goes in. I'm like, well, we just won basketball. That was one of the weirdest moments in my time because it tells you how a coach thinks. I'm thinking about the next game or the one game still going on. The other one was, another one was 2013 at Indiana on senior night. Okay. We kind of hit a little bit of a struggle. They were going to clinch the Big Ten championship that night. It was their senior night. Oladipo, Zeller, all those guys. So it was a 9 o'clock Tuesday tip. And David knows that I didn't like staying in hotels, so we're going to go over to the game. So that night, about 11:30, I text all the players. And I said, might have been made up. Can't confirm this. But I said, my security guy over there at Indiana that always takes care of me just texted me and said they got backup for the riots when Indiana wins the Big Ten championship tomorrow night. So as you would have it, we end up, I think, winning the game by 9 points. And I remember Aaron Kraft looking over at me and he goes, no celebration tonight, coach. Another one, 2012, Lloyd Buford shot at Michigan State. Off the dribble handoff, we knew they were switching, and we knew Trice would take him off the dribble handoff, and it was a great shot. Won us a share of the Big Ten championship, and that was on, I think, Draymond Green senior day, and just a great moment walking in that locker room and the excitement we had there. 2011, I know everybody remembers this game. Senior day, Johnny's senior day, the Wisconsin massacre. I'm still upset because John missed a three, and then we went on and made 14 straight threes at him. he was the first guy to miss the first one, and then we never missed again. But for those guys, that senior day, that was probably, I've always said this about coaching. There's two times when you know a player gave you everything they had. One was if they were emotional on senior day, and they were emotional on the last loss of the season.
Deal with it.
What's that?
Deal with it.
That's
deal with the game.
No doubt about it.
Yeah. There.
That was when Jerry got spit on up there. Yeah. But the next one was the Michael Conley, 12 seconds ago, 1-2 in the shot, CBS Sunday afternoon game. We win the game, we win the Big Ten championship. If they win, they get a share of it. So 12 seconds ago, we're down one. I call timeout, I'll never forget this. I go up and I say, Michael, here's what we got. We got a horns action. I really don't care which way you go. I trust you're going to make the right decision. I'll never forget Greg Rhodes sitting in the hub and goes, that's smart. Thank you, Greg. And sure enough, Michael shoots a right-hand floater. He is left-handed, but he shot a right-handed. We win the game. That was also the game where the gum incident comes and you got ticked up. If you remember in that game, I'd love to tell the story. After the game, I call my mom on my drive home, as always, I call my parents, and she answers the phone. She says, oh my God, son. I'm like, Mom? She's like, oh my God, son. I said, we won. She goes, you dropped your gun. I did not remember anything. So go home and have a huge party with the staff at my house after the game. And I said, did they put it on TV? And she goes, oh, they showed it about 100 times. Sure enough, go home, turn on ESPN, and there I am. They got the telestrator out. I will say this, that did give me a lifetime membership to Wrigley. next, and this is a true story. It's right before they're doing the starting lineups of the national championship game, our first Final Four against Florida. And to start that season, I think back then we started back October 15th, whatever it was, but I went up to Michael Conley and I handed him the basketball. And I said, Michael, run my team until I tell you to stop. So I'm sitting there and four guys have been called out, Michael's there, and I said, Michael, you remember what I told you, 75,000 people taking pictures. I said, you remember what I told you the first night of practice? He said, yes, sir, coach. He said, run your team until you tell me to stop. I said, for God's sake, don't stop now. That wasn't the moment. So we come in, we break the huddle, I'm getting ready to sit down, I feel this tap on my shoulder. It's Mark Tyus. He says, coach, I just want you to know, I'm gonna be down there at the end of the bench. I got five fouls, I can't take them with me. I tell you what, he wanted Horford. Next one was this, Ron Lewis's shot, against Xavier. I still remember Justin Cage missing that free throw, and we're coming down. If you remember, nobody ever knew at that point what a dribble out was. And Michael Conley dribbled at Ron Lewis's man, plowed him over, flipped it up, and Ron made the shot. We went overtime and ended up winning the game, and obviously kept playing for a long time. Next one, last one, or one after this, Matt Sylvester, the shot against Elmo. Now, I will say this, if you're a true fan, you remember this play 4 minutes and 42 seconds ago before this happened. Jaquel Foster was coming down in defensive transition, and he back tips a ball, goes into the press row or cheerleader, whatever was there, turns around, comes back out, back tips it again, jumps on the ball, D Brown jumps on him, foul on D Brown, it's 4-5. One of the greatest plays I've ever seen in my time. Now, let's get to the they missed the shot. Brandon Fuchsia gets the ball. He's walking the ball for the floor, like there's 39 minutes left. I'm like 30-some years old at the time. I'm sprinting down to my court saying, get the ball right here. Time out. So, go to the players are all going, the shot's going crazy. Got a chance to do something special. So I turned to my coaches and I said, what do you guys want to do? We're down 2, 64, 62, I said. First guy says, go inside Terrence. Second guy says, go inside Terrence. Last guy says, go inside Terrence. I said, are you guys crazy? You want to play these guys for 5 more minutes? He said, we're going for the win. And so I go in the huddle. I said, fellas, we're going for the win. They start celebrating like we'd already won the match. So I said, look, here's what we're going to do. I draw the play up. It's an old pen play. And they start cheering and clapping, and I said, well, we still got to make the shot, guys. So I said, let me show it to you one more time. We're bringing Tony off. He was our best shooter. Terrence is going to pin in for Matt. Matt's going to step back. We got Jaquel over in the corner. Boom. We break the huddle. Brandon Fuchsia turns to me. I swear to God, he goes, who am I passing to? Matt, you were that true story. I said, the guy that's going to be wide open. Sure enough, we won the basketball game. As Paul alluded to, that game was, and I told Matt, Paul Keel is really close. And it's coming out.
Start of the football season.
And I had the honor this summer to write a foreword for it. And I talked about in there, I still say this, that Matt and Brandon and Tommy and JJ, Terrence, Jaquel, and Matt Sylvester, they should hang their names from the top of the rack. Because what they did for Ohio State basketball is something that they put the stamp on. And that game was a huge start for them. Last thing that my last memory was last summer, my wife and Matt Troyer threw me a party in the house of my former players. The guys came from literally all over the world. All our guys are playing overseas, or NBA guys, they all show up and surprise me. To see them with their kids, to see them, you know, being successful, I was shocked they were drinking wine. I didn't like that. My wine cellar got attacked. But to see them being sophisticated, to see them be grown men, at that point we knew we'd done our job. You know, I will say this on this award tonight, and I really mean this from the bottom of my heart. I shouldn't be the recipient of this award. The Agganis Club, you guys and what you do for Ohio State, what you do for Central Ohio, you know, you look at all the changes that have transpired since you guys have had this group. Ticket prices, seat licensing, parking, concession stands. I mean, let's face it, it's not just Ohio State, but they like to grab you by the ankles and shake every cent out every time. But you guys have never needed. You guys have always been consistent, and that's just because you have a great passion for Ohio State. And the things that you guys did for our program when I was there, could never ever thank you enough. And quite honestly, you know, I say this, you guys should give yourselves the award as people of the year. But since you already did this, I'm gonna go ahead and take it.